The Tour de France continues to look south for a date in the Pyrenees and the dramatic changes that are likely to occur. Laurent Vigneault will be there, but the question is, will Greg LeMond's comeback dream still be...
And winning the Tour de France in 86, I think I went through a lot more pain to get to where I am now.
Won and lost.
Enjoy when you know the achievement and the dramatic changes that are likely to occur. Laurent Vigneault will be there, but the question is, will Greg LeMond's comeback dream still be...
And winning the Tour de France in 86, I think I went through a lot more pain to get to where I am now than I ever did in 86. 86 was a natural step. I was professional for 6 years at that time. I was third, second, and first in the Tour de France. Or third and second, and so first was a natural step. This has been a much more difficult job or work to get back to, even to the level to start the Tour de France was an accomplishment for me.
We were on the phone with your family the other day, your wife Kathy, and we heard your little son Jeffrey in the background screaming out, "Daddy won the race! Daddy won the race!"
Good.
How much does he understand about what's happening to you?
He has a pretty good idea. I think, I mean, he's 5 years old, and he's a pretty intelligent or smart little kid. And he knows what I do, but I still don't think it's nice that he's going to be able to now realize what I do. I think if I would have ended my career in 86 or 87, he'd have never really had any idea of what I do.
I head in the Tour de France, Slide the Mountains, and everyone says that's where this race is won and lost. Have you been getting the right signals from your body that says, yes, you can survive what's going to happen there?
I'm getting the right signals. I still lack the confidence that I would have if I had done well in a previous race with big mountains in it. I feel good and I'm recuperating very well each day. I'm confident I'm going to be in the top five of the Tour de France. I'm pretty confident about that, but to hang on to the yellow jersey and to win is going to be extremely difficult.
Congratulations, Greg. It's been exciting to watch.
All right, thank you.
He rode to the front on their strength. His teammate had been Bernard Hinault and Laurent Vigneault. Vigneault, who right now, ironically, is his closest pursuer. And those two men between them had won the Tour a total of 7 times. Greg was 25 years old, and in his adult life, he had done little else than ride a bicycle. Today, 3 years later, he wears the yellow jersey again. And this time, he has done something that is wholly his own achievement. Yes, he's uncertain about the mountains ahead, and he doesn't know how long he will be able to wear that jersey. But Greg LeMond is not unsure about himself. One thing Greg knows how to do is to lead this race without letting the pressures that go with the lead disrupt his routine, especially for eating and sleeping. Enjoy the yellow jersey. Don't let it overwhelm you.
I feel good, and I expect maybe I can have a very good overall place. To win is another question. It takes a lot to win the Tour de France, and I'm not sure if I'm ready. I think I am, but I'm not sure. I lack a little confidence coming back.
Respect. So desperately desired, so richly enjoyed, when you know the achievement of it has brought you exactly where you want to be. For Greg LeMond, little pats on the back actually are firm handshakes from his peers. Those who know exactly what he's been through, coming back in a world only they really know. Pedro Delgado, too, is sharing in the good feeling of a job well done at the end of a week gone bad. In one day, he shaved 3 minutes off his deficit. While Englishman Sean Yates of 7-Eleven, his leg bloody raw a day ago, reveals the magic doctors can work.
The next morning, after the time trial, the atmosphere is once more amicable. The mental and physical pressures giving way to a temporary truce. And LeMond was in yellow for the first time in 3 years.
This is the longest stage of the tour. Destination, a conference center amusement area called Futuroscope, where architecture has gone mad over geometric steel and glass. Futuroscope will be the site of the start of next year's race.
The peloton is a beast of many parts, moving as one. In a sense, its identity comes from the rider hidden protectively in its center, who wears the yellow jersey. For 2 days, it was De Silva of Portugal. Now it is LeMond of America. And as they roll south through France, the pace is easy and relaxed.
On his glove, which allowed his wedding band to be clearly visible, Greg LeMond has Team LeMond written in large letters. But in reality, he knows his ADR team, in unity, will help him protect his lead, aerodynamically and emotionally, as long as they can. But the start team so far is Super U. Fignon behind LeMond, and Thierry Marie only seconds behind him. Teamwork in cycling. It works to the end, as it does in many sports. To Americans, baseball is a game that captures imagination, forces even the casual fan to strategize, links the past with the present, fills a summer evening, and makes one wish he could be Babe Ruth for a day. Across the ocean lies the fantasy to cycle like one Eddie Merckx, or maybe just sit by the roadside as the tour whizzes by. The intricacies of both sports are different, yet they can be similar in many ways. Baseball is played by nine men, focused to the team effort, and so is cycling. The stars are high-priced, and everyone fills a role. In cycling, there's a man known as a domestique who sometimes has to sacrifice his individual effort, giving up a wheel or even his bike to the team leader. Such a moment exists in baseball when a batter sacrifices his chance to get a hit for the good of the team. Self-sacrifice means glory for others at times, but a win for the group. In the dugout, the trainer is a player's friend and a solver of muscle mysteries. The Swan Euro sounds romantic, but describes the same role. Both sports base success on good equipment. Look to the coaches to deploy the team's equipment, and look to the equipment manager who may oil a glove instead of a chain. The director sportive is the main brain of every cycling team. Who plays and for how long, team strategy, and fame all are part of a successful effort. The director sportive then is the manager who makes all the moves, praised for the bold strokes, and maybe becomes famous in the process. If all goes according to plan, when the big moment arrives, the right man has been chosen for the job, and he appropriately hits a home run. Careful planning, a team image, pressure to succeed, and everyone working together to reach that goal. Out on the road to a team like 7-Eleven, all this means that some men will be hitting sacrifice flies so that in the end, one may hit a home run in Paris.
When you're in the peloton, the riders describe the sound as a buzz. Chains on the sprockets, wheels on the ground, hundreds in unison, creating a noise. A long day and a flat road offer little opportunity for the leaders to attack. It's a perfect day for lessermen like Joel Pellier to make a gentle exit and face 100 miles alone.
Joel Pellier, 27, is no stranger to breakaways. In fact, he has a reputation for attempting them. Pellier has a younger brother, Christian, who is paralyzed. Joel's mother has never seen him race, but she has driven 600 miles to wait for him at the finish of this day.
Pellier was unceremoniously fired by Fignon's team Super U a year ago. Now he's a rarity, a Frenchman on the Spanish team BH. The pace of the peloton remains unchanged. Laurent Fignon and Greg LeMond are with that group, which has decided to let Pellier go ahead. He's not anyone that they're worried about. Maybe the peloton is being dangerously blasé. For Pellier, only trailed LeMond by 9.5 minutes when the day began, and now his lead over that group is 17 minutes and 20 seconds. He knows that because Bernard Hinault, Tour legend and five-time winner, told him so. The smell of bread, of popping corks, of pate, and when the peloton goes by, liniment. The fragrances of the tour. His mom and dad are now wet and nervous at the finish. Their son's lead is down to 12 minutes. Anyone can break away from the peloton, but talent and desire and luck must be in place for you to stay. Peloton can't erase the lead fast enough as we first over coaches, but also the race winners.
His attack has lasted now almost 4 hours. The weather will help him too, while others dodge the wet. Rising unexpectedly doubled today, the peloton now have another reason to finally flex their muscles. Open in the morning, Pellier on stage in the afternoon had gained all the time he lost the previous week. Donald Fignon, still 5 seconds behind Greg LeMond, now joins in the 30-mile-an-hour pursuit in an attempt to conserve the status quo.
Pellier's lead, now less than 2 minutes, has fallen like a rock. But now, the finish line is safely within reach.
This is the longest successful breakaway of the last 10 years, and the career highlight for a man who has had some real ups and downs, including a victory in last year's Tour of Luxembourg, for which he was then disqualified following a positive doping test.
For Joel Pellier, the reality of the yellow jersey doesn't exist right now in this race, but the reality of winning the stage in the Tour de France, a dream thousands of cyclists have, and doing it in front of his mother and father, is now.
This seems to happen two or three times each year in the Tour de France, that one man with no chance to win and not really part of the development of the race will emerge from the pack for a single day of glory.
The peloton is now weaving a wet, frenetic band, making sure the lead they allow Pellier is as small as possible when it's over. LeMond and Fignon help stir the mix. It's not easy to deflect the attention of the Tour de France away from the yellow jersey, but Joel Pellier has done that in stage six. 161 miles in 6 hours, 57 and 45, LeMond, Delgado and Fignon finished shoulder to shoulder. The battle for the yellow jersey remains unchanged as Craig LeMond crossed the line at a pack number 182.
So Greg LeMond wears the yellow jersey for the second time this year. The status quo is preserved. On this day, the story is Joel Pellier, a story about a man whose perception of himself will be changed by what he achieved today. Quite a thing for his mother to have chosen this day to see her son race. Or was it because she did come that he raced so well?
Joan of Arc first started getting into trouble and ending in Bordeaux for the 71st time in Tour history, 160.5 miles. Early morning, and the star of the Tour de France emerges from sleep. For the second stage in a row, American Greg LeMond will wear the yellow jersey as the leader of the race. Laurent Fignon is so close to Greg, they might as well be tied. Pedro Delgado has been equally strong. What was almost 10 minutes is now less than 7.
With the first mountains lying in wait just 200 miles along the route, the flat roads to Bordeaux should be a pleasant meander in warm sunshine. But instead, the wet skies make for an unpleasant beginning. Stephen Rooks, 7 minutes 30 behind, more content now with putting a cape on than making up the time he's lost. And Greg LeMond, with permission from the Tour organization, changes his yellow jersey for a new team one and an extra cape as well. It really is a day for dogs.
Greg talks with Cyril Guimard, who recognized his talent early and offered him the job that brought Greg to Europe in the first place. Guimard today manages the man who rides second to Greg in the race, Laurent Fignon. On the Tour de France, the riders of the peloton are known as the convicts of the road because they are chained to the destiny of the peloton. When it rolls, they roll. Rain or shine.
Events like this have helped knock some of the 7 men who have already dropped out of the Tour de France. A wild crash sends the winner of Stage 3, Raul Alcala, to the ground, tossing him painfully to the side of the road. Bad timing for Alcala, who is nearing the mountains where he excels. Medical care, like just about everything on the Tour, is provided on the go. This bridge, shrouded in the mist, marks the official entry to the land of wine. At the finish, it's a sprint to the line, spearheaded by Etienne de Wilde, who wins his first stage ever, while the peloton, 4 seconds back, all receives the same time. As a result, the Belgians record their first win on the Tour this year. While all the leaders were in the peloton, and because they were all credited identically, each of the time differentials remains the same. Greg LeMond and Laurent Fignon lead the way, separated by 5 seconds. Andy Hampson, 4:44 back, and Pedro Delgado still comfortably in the hunt. For Greg LeMond, he'll feel the joy of the yellow jersey one more day. But pressure will replace joy when the Tour hits hills that will remain when the day is done. The mountains lie ahead, and from them, the winner will likely emerge. After an arduous comeback, Greg LeMond leads the race, wearing yellow and standing at the summit of cycling. The duel right now includes Laurent Fignon of France, trailing by only 5 seconds, and the deficit erasing charge of Pedro Delgado. This is the Tour de France, cycling where the legends have been, adding to the history of 86 years, chasing not just a shirt, but the symbol of cycling's number one. I'm Al Troutwig, reporting from the beautiful hilltop town of Pau in southwestern France. This is the gateway to the Pyrenees Mountains and the challenge that they represent to the 191 cyclists who are left in the 1989 Tour de France. It comes to mind that the Tour is like a big, heavy, runaway train without brakes gathering momentum along the way. The cyclists are passengers on the train, and they're trying to grab control of it. Right now, that control is held by American Greg LeMond, who surprisingly has won the yellow jersey and leads the Tour de France.
I'm too young and too much potential to stop this early. See, it gets tempting when you're injured and you're riding with guys that 3 years ago I wouldn't have had a hard time beating with one leg. Now I'm having a hard time staying with them. And that's when you start saying, geez, can I stay in this sport any longer? Will I ever get better? And sooner or later it does turn around. All you need is that one extra good ride and all of a sudden you're back on top. Especially the majority of the European journalists, exactly. It's the they take pleasure in building you up for an instant, and they take more pleasure in knocking you down and rubbing you to the ground. You can't even have an injury in this sport without them immediately saying you're finished. But I know that they're not the experts. Only the rider will know if he's going to come back. The only reason why I race and do it professionally is for my family, and the only way I can do it is with my family. I could never do what I'm doing without my wife, my kids, and my parents. I think whenever I perform well, it's when my parents, my wife shows. When they show up to the race, I perform. There's no athletic event that's as hard as the Tour de France, and I can challenge anybody in the world on that. There's no athletic event that makes you race at such a high level for 3 weeks. There's certainly events for one day that can challenge a Tour de France stage or whatever, marathon, cross-country ski race, or triathlon. Nothing ever tests an athlete like the Tour de France.
Armagnac, home of the adult beverage of Armagnac. But that is only part of the lore of a medieval place more than 7 centuries old. It is the starting place for today's Stage 8, a relatively short jaunt of 97.5 miles, which brings the cyclists closer to the Pyrenees. A nuclear protest greets them, and finding it all very boring is Bernard Hinault, who has seen it all on the Tour.
Through the years, there have been any number of protests which used the Tour as a platform. This one represents a sensitive issue in France. The cyclists are led carefully through the lines to the start. La Bastide d'Armagnac is hosting the Tour for the first time this year. Small villages like this one may have to lobby for years to have the Tour visit them. And when it finally happens, they make the most of the opportunity. This is Father Joseph Massey of the Church of Notre Dame des Cyclistes. The statue is of the Virgin Protector of lovers of cycling. Stephen Roach, winner of the Tour 2 years ago, greets Father Massey, himself a cycling enthusiast who founded the church 30 years ago. Englishman Sean Yates looks on. Greg LeMond presents his jersey to the father, thus following in the tradition of other great champions like Eddy Merckx and Jacques Anquetil.
The peloton is down to 188 men. 10 have been left behind, and now so has the protest and the proud priest. The strategy of this stage will be interesting, for a gamble may only burn you out for the big climbs which begin tomorrow. Greg LeMond still leads the way. However, when nature calls, you answer and drop back to the privacy at the side of the road. Then, pay the price, pedaling back to the pack. LeMond easily rejoins the peloton, and in doing so, is right back with everyone who wants to beat him. The question is there someone in that group who is going to give it a try? Maybe later take him up on it, but for now there'll be no clinking glasses, for the chase is on again. 50 miles to the finish, four men lead the way.
For the time being, this is the final chance for the hares to outrun the hounds before the mountains welcome the tour once more. These four men who race ahead with the 50 miles to go are Martin Early, the Irishman, 13 minutes back. Michael Wilson, an Australian, lying 5 minutes off. And two Frenchmen, Philippe Louviot, half an hour behind, and France's national champion, Eric Carritu. His deficit, 9 minutes. The peloton stay together, the pace being set by the team of Greg LeMond, the yellow jersey. The ADR squad all look to their leader, making sure he's safe, carrying him towards the finishing pole, ready for the fight that is sure to come. For the time being, the four escapers stay ahead.
And the Reynolds team stay with their star, Pedro Delgado. Tomorrow he will reach the mountains, where it will be up to him to resume his effort to win back lost time.
Laurent Fignon waves to his team, seeming to say, come on, I've got an idea, let's break. But maybe just another shrewd move of gamesmanship to keep the peloton on its toes. The roads get windy on the way to Po, and there are some uphill climbs and downhill descents. That began 1.2 miles ago, Martin Early streaks to the finish. He is an Irishman. So is Sean Kelly, one of the great cyclists of all time. And so is Stephen Roach, who once starred and won the Tour de France. Early can never hope to be like them. He can only hope to achieve great moments in his career, great moments like this. For winning a stage in the Tour de France is something Martin Early may never do again. The peloton streaks to the finish. They are 178 strong, 20 seconds back, and include Fignon, Delgado, and Greg LeMond. So Martin Early, after much frustration in his career, wins his first stage of the Tour de France. The men of the peloton, 20 seconds back. Greg LeMond and Laurent Fignon still now 5 seconds apart. Roy King is a name to watch. Andy Hampton trails by 4:44, and Pedro Delgado is still part of the mix. So the first wild week of the Tour comes to an end with an exclamation point provided by Greg LeMond. Pedro Delgado of Spain has put the early embarrassment behind him and now enters the mountains, where the embarrassment can be felt by someone else. Laurent Fignon continues to be intriguing in appearance, dedication, and strategy. Over the last few stages, it seems France loves him again. Greg LeMond sleeps with the yellow jersey again tonight. What he'll dream about is a mystery, considering one of his biggest ones has already come true.